Hello students, in this lesson let us discuss about the accessibility and size of harbors. So we'll see how exactly the access to the harbor should be there, and we'll see what exactly should be the size of the harbor, and we'll see what are the factors be considered when we are designing a harbors so that the accessibility and size of harbors are taken care of. So to get started with, your accessibility normally depends upon the location of your harbor. So the harbor entrance should be designed and located for quick and easy navigation by ships overtaken by storm. At the same time, it should also be narrow enough so that it is not exposed or affected by the stormy sea. Okay, so easy and quick access should be there, and narrow access should be there. This is for movement, and this is for retaining it from the sea storms. Okay, so the maximum dimension of up to 180 meters is adopted for the entrance of the harbor or accessibility of the harbor. So the entrance is generally placed with a passage to the interior of the harbor, so arranged as to minimum the effect of the rough sea. Okay, that is how you have to make the entrance of the harbor. Coming to the size of the harbor, it depends upon the number and sizes of ship, right? Accessibility purely depends upon the location, and your size of the harbor will purely depend upon what? The number of ships that will come into the harbor and their size, the ship size. Okay, how big, how small the ships are, based on that it will be depending. And at one time how many of them are coming, it will depend. Okay, so biggest modern ships are about 275 meter to 300 meter long and 30 meter wide. Okay, so these are the normal size of ships. So based on this, we have to take into the consideration. Okay, there should be sufficient area for maneuvering them without collision. Okay, so that you can park them easily. The major factors on which the size depends are the accommodation required. So how much of accommodation is required, how much of ships will stay at a single time in the harbor, right? And convenience for turning, right? Convenience of turning, or the other name for this is what? Maneuvering. Then it is the adaptability to natural features. Regarding the entrance width, the narrower the entrance, the better is the interior protection. So it should be small, the entrance should be small, but also it should not be so small that the ships cannot enter. Okay, consistent with easy and quick entry or exit of a bigger vessel using the harbor. So even when the breakwaters are high enough to protect the harbor, wave from outside the harbor will not come into the inside of the harbor. Based on that also, your entrance width will be dependent. So entrance width is one of the important criteria. Okay, we have an empirical formula for calculating the entrance width. Empirical formula. This is given by Stevenson, scientist name Stevenson. It has limited application, but your h is equal to under root small l by capital L minus 0.027 fourth root of d into 1 plus l by l into capital H. So this is the empirical formula. So here capital H is height in meters. Of unrestricted wave. So when there is an unrestricted wave, how much of height it is coming, that we have to calculate, right? Especially at entrance of harbor, right? Then L is the mouth width at the entrance. Mouth width at entrance, right? H is your reduced height. Reduced height of diminuted wave. Diminuted means already the wave have come inside. Now how much the height has been reduced? Okay, inside the harbor, that height is your height small h. And wherever we calculate this distance h, there we will get what? Capital D. That is your distance in meter. Distance in meters. From where? From the mouth. From the mouth of harbor. Say for example, say if this is your breakwater, this is your seashore, right? So let us discuss these terms. So here at the entrance, this is entrance. Let us write entry. So here, whatever is the height of the wave, that will be taken as H. This length of the entrance will be taken as L. Reduced height. Suppose here somewhere I'm calculating the height of the wave, then I'll call this as small h. And this distance from the entrance till here, it is called as capital D. So these are what? Your breakwaters. And this is your shore. This is your harbor area. Understood? Hope this is clear to you. So this formula is applicable to a distance of 15 meters from the entrance and where the harbor is well protected by a vertical seawall. So there should be seawall and the entrance distance is limited up to 15 meters. Only if these two conditions satisfy, you can use this particular formula given by Stevenson. Right, there are many other factors which will affect the accessibility and size of the harbor. Okay, so let us see one by one what are those. So the accessibility and size of harbor will depend upon these 10 things. The first one is what? Your site selection. Second one, shape of the harbors, harbor depth, marine survey, harbor planning, features of a port, defects in harbor, requirements of a good harbor, ship characteristics and terms common for ship characteristics. So all this we have to see in detail. Right, so let us start doing one by one. So the first one is what? The site selection. So great care has to be exercised at the time of making site selection for the harbor. So the guiding factor which will play a very important role in the choose of site of harbors are many. So let us list one by one. So the first one is availability of cheap land and construction material, right? Second one is your transportation and communication facilities should be there at the place where you are selecting your harbor. Okay, transportation and communication facilities. Next, normally we should try to check for natural protections from your wind and tide. Okay. If they are not there, we will build artificial, or we will go for only few part of there. We will go for what? Semi natural. But we will have to try to find natural protections from the wind and waves. Okay. Next one is what? There should be some industrial development around the place where you are trying to come up with the herbal. Okay. Industrial development should be there. Then we have to take care of the seabed, subsoil, and foundation condition. So we have to check for all this before coming up with the harbor, right? Then traffic potentiality means how much of traffic can be taken up in that particular harbor. That also we have to take care. Then next is the availability of fresh water as well as electricity. So the place where we go for a harbor, it should have fresh water as well as what? Electricity that is being generated there, or else your harbor won't be able to run, right? Then favorable marine condition should be there. Too heavy, huge waves should not be there, or favorable marine conditions. Then some defense and strategic aspects also should be considered while we are going for a selection of harbor. Okay. So these are some of the criteria that will come under the site selection. So the second one is the shape of the harbors. So while deciding the shape of the harbors, we have to keep some of the principle in mind. Okay. So what are those principles which we have to keep in mind? The first one is, whenever we are building the backwaters, or what you can call as pier heads. So what are pier heads? In your break walls, these are called as pier heads. We have to make sure, see, if you observe, these both pier heads are not coming at the same position. There is a gap between these two pier heads. So one pier head should be ahead of the other. We have to make sure that we are giving this particular thing. Then the second one is, inside pier head, the width of this whatever harbor is there. Now here at the entrance of pier head, you see only small width, right? So, but as soon as you enter into the pier head, the width should be made large immediately. So inside the pier head, the width of the harbor should be very large. Inside the pier head, width of the harbor should be made what? Large. Right. Next, third one. The general shape of the harbor should be obtained by a series of straight length, and no reentrant angle should be allowed. So we have to make sure that they all of straight lengths like this. Like, so that's the points which we have to take into consideration when we are going for the shape of the harbor, right? The next one is your harbor depth. How much depth should be there for your harbor is very, very important, right? It is normally given by a formula, capital D is equal to D1 plus H by 3 plus D2. What is D1 here? Draft of large ship to be accommodated. Draft means what? How much extra space should be there below your ship? So the largest ship that will come into that particular harbor, we have to take that and see how much of draft is remaining for us. We have to calculate that. So that is your D1. Next, D2 is allowance for squirt of moving ship. That is your D2. H is what? The height of the storm wave. How much height If there is any storm, how much is the maximum height that we'll get? That is the height of the storm wave. So using this formula, we can calculate the depth of the harbor. So thus the harbor and approach channel should be of sufficient depth to allow navigation at low water when ships are fully loaded. So low water, remember this, low water, ships fully loaded. This is the worst condition which we have to take into consideration, and we have to decide the depth. So it must be ensured that there are no obstructions like boulders or sunken ship above the required depth for safe navigation. Okay, so the maximum harbor depth below the lowest low water should be as follows. Okay, so what is the maximum harbor depth? So this should be loaded draft of the highest or the heaviest ship which is coming inside plus 1.2 meters. This will come for soft bed. If the below surface in the water is soft bed, we have to go for this. If it is hard bed, then we have to go for 1.8 meters. So if the bottom is what? Hard bed. So this is about your harbor depth. Then the fourth one is your marine surveys. So it is necessary for us to collect all the sufficient information about the area before finalizing the layout of the harbor or the design of various components of the harbor. So normally your marine surveying is carried out in two parts. First one is the hydrographic survey. In this, everything about water will be surveyed, right? And the next one is the topographic survey. So how exactly is your land surface below, beside your harbor? All those things we have to survey in this particular thing, right? So if you speak about the hydrographic survey, becomes easy at places where local tests and minor trigonometrical controls are available. So it consists of locating the shoreline at low and high tide level positions of the structure or obstructions in the water and along the shore. So what all we should do in hydrographic survey? What all we should do? Shoreline, we have to decide, right, at low as well as high tide condition. Then we have to look if there are any obstructions inside and outside your water, right? So this also we have to take care. Then the depth of the sea bottom are obtained by use of a frathometer or echo sounder designed for the hydrographic survey. Next thing what we have to take care is what? The depth of the water. Depth of water also should be surveyed. This can be done by two equipments, frathometer or echo sounded. So what they will do is they will take these devices and start recording at a surrounding of 7.5 meter interval along the range line, 15 meters to 30 meters apart, depending upon how is the nature of the bed and what is the extent of details which we want. Once this data is collected, a hydrographic charts are then prepared, and with the help of this, they will try to come up with the design of the harbor, right? So this is all about your hydrographic survey. Now, if you want to discuss about the topographic survey, this survey is carried out at the ground contours at an interval. How the ground is there below your water, how the ground is there, that contour we need to take care, right? So we normally do it at a counter interval of 0.5 meters to 1.5 meters. The higher the counter interval is used where the terrain is rough and in areas where it is little or no construction work of any importance, then prominent irregularities at 30 meter interval should also be carefully examined. So in addition to all this, we have to locate if there are any existing buildings or structures, if there are any borings or test pits, and if there are any permanent landmarks. All these things we have to take care in the topographic survey. Okay. So the next one is the harbor planning. The planning of the harbor should be carried out after collecting the necessary information existing at the proposed site. Okay. The important facts to be studied and scrutinized are as follows. The first one is what neighboring survey we have to carry out, like we do in the first category, that is the site selection, right? So all the things which are required in the site selection we need to carry out, including the foreshore features and the depth of the water in the vicinity, right? Then boring and surroundings should be taken to ascertain the characteristics of the ground. So we have to study what the characteristics of the land. Then the nature of the harbor should be decided. Whether it is a sheltered one or an unsheltered one, so that has to be decided. Okay, let us write it because it's important. Sheltered or not, that we need to decide. Then if there are any sea insects, we have to check for it so that we take care of the foundation of the harbor. Okay. Then we should check if there is any problem pertaining to silting or erosion of coastline. Then the natural meteorological phenomena should be studied at site, especially with respect to the frequency of storms, rains, range of tides, maximum and minimum temperature, then direction and intensity of the wind, humidity, all these things we have to study while we are doing the harbor planning. Then the next one is the feature of the port. So how exactly your port should be there, what all feature it should have, is the next thing to consider. So it should have an entrance channel, right? Then it should have a approach channel. Then turning basin, so that your ships can turn, right? Breathing basin. Breathing is the parking area of the ships. Okay. Then we have to have backwaters, breakwaters. Then the quays and wharves. Then jetties and piers should be there. Docks should be there. Spillways should be there. Or slipways you can call, should be there. And some godowns, sheds. Lights. Fire protection towers, etc., also should be there. So all these things should be there in your basin. So the term turning basin used to mean a water area inside the harbor or an enlargement of the channel that will help us to permit the turning of the ships. So where space is available, the radius of turning basin should be at least equal to the double the length of the ships to permit easy free turning or turning with the aid of tugs if necessary. However, if there are limitation in the availability of the space, the ships may be turned by wrapping around the ends of the pier. And for such circumstances, we have to have the shape as a triangular or a rectangular shape. Okay, so these are about the features of the port. Moving on to the next point is the defects in the harbor. So we have to, usually the defects which are noticed in the construction of many harbors are limited. So the important ones or the ones which were considered the most are the size of the harbor, whatever we select, no? If there is any increase in the harbor to accommodate those, it will become very difficult. Okay, so that is one of the defect. Second one is the depth of water proves to be insufficient for the ships to breathe safely in certain places. So that is one of the defect of your harbor. Next is what? The queuing or landing area between the berths is very narrow, and thus there is no enough room for the cargoes to be stored. Okay, between two ships the space will be very less. That is what is the meaning. Then if in case the whole area gets congested, then the proper functioning of the harbor will not be possible, right? So that is one of the major disadvantage or defect in a harbor, right? So these defects can be avoided if an eye is kept on the possible expansion of the harbor and providing necessary facilities all in the advance only. These defects can be taken care of, right? Then is the requirement of a good harbor. Right, there are main four requirements. The first one is the ship channels, which either be natural or artificial, must have sufficient depth for the draft of vehicles visiting the harbor. So depth of water should be sufficient. Again, whatever is in the drawback will come in as your requirement. Okay, so depth of water should be sufficient, and the bottom should furnish secured anchor to hold the ship against the force of wind, and if there is any heavy wind or heavy wave, the bottom should be in such a way that they will hold the ships in place. That is one of the requirement. Then the land masses, also called as what, your breakwaters, must be provided in order to protect the entire harbor from the effect of heavy winds and waves. And your entrance should be wide enough so that it permits ships to move around at the same time, as well as it should be narrow enough so that not massive amount of wind energy or wave energy will come inside. So it should be taken care of. Right. So it may be noted that previously more emphasis was given on what? Protection work like seawall, breakwaters. Right. But in these recent times, the more emphasis has shifted to deeping of channel because of drastic change in the size of the ship. Previously, the size of the ships were very less. Now the size of the ships are going on increasing. Right. So the focus has shifted on deepening the channel rather than going for the protection works. Okay, the next is your ship characteristics. So there are certain ship characteristics which we have to take care of. So the size of the harbors again is dependent upon the ship characteristics. So what all characteristics of the ship are important? Let us see one by one. So first one is the type of ship we are using, or a type of ship that is entering into the harbor. That will determine the land requirement. Next will be what? The depth and width of ship that will visit your harbor. Because the dimension of the largest ship is likely to be used as the reference for constructing your harbor. Right. Next one. The next point is the quantity of traffic. So how many ships are going to come at particular instant of time. That is also one of the factor or characteristic of ship that will affect the size of the harbor. So whether we have to go for a single lane or a double lane entry, all those things will be decided. Then some minor factors like your speed of ship, alignment of channel, all these also will impact the harbor development. Right. Nextly, there are some terms for ship characteristics which we have to understand. So let us get it into the point 10. So the first one is your load line, or it is also called as plimsoll mark. Plimsoll mark. So this term is named after the English statesman in 1824 to 98 who survived there. And it indicates a line or set of lines on the outside merchant ship which will show the water level to which they may legally be loaded. So up to that particular line only they can load the ship. So that particular thing is called as your load line, and it was this person who made it, who found out this. So it was called as plimsoll mark. Okay, next, the second one is the displacement load. Displacement load. Now, what is displacement load? The weight of ship and its content when fully loaded with cargo to the load line is known as the displacement load. Right? It should be fully loaded to the load line. Then whatever, however much load it will take, no, that ship or the cargo, that weight of the ship is called as the displacement load. Then next one is the displacement light. The weight of ship in kilonewton without cargo, fuel or storage is known as displacement light. So let us write weight of ship without cargo, fuel and stores. This is what? This is weight of ship fully loaded to load line. Up to load line, whatever weight can be put, that they'll put and find the weight of the ship. That is your displacement load. Next, fourth one is the dead weight tonnage. Now, what is dead weight tonnage? The difference between the displacement load and the displacement light. So let us call displacement load as LO, DLO, and displacement light as DLI. So the difference between DLO and DLI will be your deadweight tonnage. Okay, so it varies with latitude and season. So to represent the carrying capacity of the ship and is the means of tropical summer and winter dead weight. Okay, so next is your gross tonnage. So the carrying capacity of the ship expressed in volume measurement is known as what? Your gross tonnage. So carrying capacity of ship in terms of volume is known as gross tonnage. Next one is your net tonnage. What is your net tonnage? The difference between the gross tonnage and the space provided for the crew or machinery or engine room or fuel is known as your net tonnage. Okay, so difference between gross tonnage and space provided for crew, fuel, machinery, engine room, etc. So that is your net tonnage. So let us underline the words which we have studied. Right. The next one is what? The seventh one is your cargo tonnage. The name itself is indicating. What is it? It is a commercial expression which forms the basis of freight charge. So it is also known as freight tonnage and can be measured either by volume or by weight. So based on this weight only, your exchange of amount will happen. Okay, so this is also called as freight tonnage. Okay, next, the last one, what we have is ballast. We also know this term. We have studied it in railway engineering. But here, the weight added to improve the stability of the ship when it has discharged its cargo is known as your ballast. So, weight added to the ship for stability. Okay, so this is all about your accessibility and size of harbor. Hope you have understood it. Thank you.